We're beginning a new sermon series today called I Smile. And this came about because I thought, you know, around Thanksgiving, I should preach thankful sermons. And I thought, but I don't want to preach ordinary thankful sermons. I want to do something a little bit different. And I thought, you know, one of the things that most of us know that we ought to be thankful, we're aware of that, and the Bible commands us to be thankful. We get that. But for some of us, there are some things that keep robbing us of our joy. There are some things that keep robbing us of our thankfulness, some issues that we confront over and over again in life that are destroying our joy. And so that's what I want to talk about for the next 3 weeks. I want to talk about recovering joy, defeating those things that rob us of joy. And today, I want us to begin that, thinking about that, with a clip from the best television show ever made. And of course, when I say that, we all know what I'm talking about. It's Andy Griffith. It's undisputed the best television show ever made. There's no argument, so don't even try. Absolutely amazing television. Now, I have got for us today, though, a clip, one of the best moments of the best show ever on television. Now, I'm going to set this up for you so you understand what's going on. It's the Mr. McBeebe episode. All of you, and if you don't know it, you should watch it over and over until you memorize all the Andrew Griffin episodes. Mr. McBeebe, Opie's met a guy named Mr. McBeebe, and Mr. McBeebe, Opie tells his dad that Mr. McBeebe climbs around in trees, he jingles, and that he can blow smoke out of his ears, and he wears a shiny hat, and this story that Opie's telling his dad sounds really crazy, and Opie's been playing with an imaginary horse and everything, and so Andy thinks that Opie is once again talking about an imaginary person that he's made up, and Andy's told Opie over and over, forget it, Mr. McBeebe's not real, but Opie's brought home some money and an axe that he said Mr. McBeebe gave to him, and so Andy's now really troubled that Opie's imagination has run amok, and now he's stealing stuff from people. So Andy's got Opie here in a moment. Get your tissue out. And Andy's finally confronting Opie that something has to change. And so watch this.
You was having this morning galloping around the backyard on Blackie. We was both enjoying that little game. Of course, now the truth is there never was any real Blackie. That's just something that you made up. Isn't that right? Well, about this Mr. McBeebe. Maybe the same thing happened there. Maybe you made him up, too, just for fun, and there's nothing wrong with that. What's wrong is using a Mr. McBeebe to get out of work and to explain things that seem to come from nowhere. Hope there comes a time when you have to stop the play acting, tell the truth. And that time's now. Right now. Hope, I want you to be man enough to tell me that Mr. McBeebe is just make-believe. That's all you have to say, and it'll all be forgotten. But if you don't, then something else is gonna happen. I believe you know what I mean, don't you?
Yes, Paul.
All right. Tell the truth. Just go ahead and say right out, Mr. McBeebe is just make-believe. Well, go ahead.
Mr. McBeebe is just...
Say it.
I can't, Paul. Mr. McBeebe isn't make-believe. He's real.
Opie.
Don't you believe me, Paul? Don't you, Paul?
I believe.
Well, what's wrong with the boy making up an imaginary character?
Well, what about the hatchet and the coin?
Well, still, that's no re... Andy?
No. I didn't spank him.
Oh, well, that's good. Just not necessary. He learned his lesson. Good talking to is the best thing, making him stay in his room.
I didn't do that either.
Well, what did you do?
I told him I believed him.
You told him you believed... But, Andy, what he told you is impossible.
Well, a whole lot of times I've asked him to believe things that to his mind must seem just as impossible.
Oh, but Andy, this silver hat and the jingling and the smoke from the ears, what about all that?
Oh, I don't know, Barn. I guess it's a time like this when you're asked to believe something that just don't seem possible. That's the moment that decides whether you got faith in somebody or not.
Yeah, but how can you explain it all?
I can't.
But you do believe in Mr. McBeavy?
No. I do believe in Opie.
You may not remember what I say today, but I hope you remember what Andy said today. And what he said was, it's those times when you're asked to believe the impossible. That's when you decide whether you have faith in somebody or not. It's the times when you're asked to believe the impossible that decides whether you have faith in somebody or not. And Barney says, well, do you believe all that stuff? And Andy says, you know what? I don't know about all that stuff, but I believe in hope. I'm going to tell you, believing, having faith in someone, when you see evidence to the contrary, is one of the secrets to discovering joy. Because for all of us, there are going to be some times in life when life doesn't make sense. There are going to be times when we don't understand what's going on. There are going to be times when the story that somebody is telling us just doesn't seem to add up, and somebody's going to say, trust me. And sometimes that somebody who says, trust me, is going to be God. And if you've lived very long, you're going to have some times in life when you look at what God is up to and you get angry at God, when you get disappointed with God, when you question what God is thinking or why God isn't working the way that you ought to think that God ought to work, and you think that God ought to be doing something, and instead, God is silent. And in those moments when God is silent, when God doesn't act the way you think he ought to act, when God calls you to believe something about his love, when he calls you to believe something about his grace, something about his power, something about your life, something about your future, when he calls you to believe something that doesn't seem to match the circumstances of your life, it's then that you decide whether you have faith or not. It's in those times when God is silent. And the key to knowing joy throughout all circumstances of life is simply being able to say, I don't understand what's going on, but I believe in him. Because the silence of God is real and it's biblical. Job experienced the silence of God. Many of you may know the story of Job, and I love how the story begins here in Job chapter 1, verse 1. It kind of tells what a great guy Job was. It says this: in the land of Uz there lived a man whose name was Job. This man was blameless and upright. He feared God and shunned evil. He had 7 sons and 3 daughters, and he owned 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 yoke of oxen, and 500 donkeys, and had a large number of servants. He was the greatest man among all the people of the East. The scripture says that he was a very, 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 very wealthy man. It goes on to say this about Job, though. His sons used to take turns holding feasts in their homes, and they would invite their 3 sisters to eat and drink with them. Now, you know what? You know how great a guy Job was? All 10 of his kids got along. I mean, that's what the scripture's telling you. The 7 sons would have feasts, and they would invite their sisters to come and to feast with them. And it was just one big, giant, happy family. How many of you got 10 brothers and sisters, and they would all get along? I mean, that's the kind of guy that Job was. It goes on to say, when the period of feasting had run its course, Job would send and have them purified. Early in the morning, he would sacrifice a burnt offering for each of them, thinking, perhaps my children have sinned and cursed God in their hearts. This was Job's regular custom. Listen, the children would go and be purified and ask God for the forgiveness of their sins, but Job would do it again. He would go above and beyond what was necessary just in case the children had sinned in their hearts with a bad thought or something. Job wanted to make sure that everything was covered and that everybody was right before God. And this is how far Job would go. And he did it on a regular basis. This is an exceptional guy. I mean, this is a righteous guy. This is a guy who's doing everything that God asked him to do. And yet the scripture tells us in the book of Job that Job lost everything. He lost his family. He lost his children. He lost his wealth. He lost his health. He lost everything. And the book of Job is Job simply struggling with why God is silent when God should be acting. And Job says, God, I don't understand what you're up to. I don't understand why you're not acting in the midst of this. When I've done everything that you've asked me to do, I'm the person you called me to be. And why don't you do something? Why are you silent when you should be acting? It's the silence of God that sometimes robs us of our joy. Job's not the only one. John the Baptist knew the silence of God. You remember John the Baptist was a relative of Jesus. Jesus himself said that John the Baptist was a great man. John the Baptist was full of faith. He had courage. He did what God asked him to do. And yet, when John the Baptist critiqued Herod for marrying his sister-in-law, he stole his brother's wife. When John the Baptist critiqued Herod, he was thrown into prison. And not only that, John knew that Herod's wife, Herodias, didn't like him and was going to kill him. And that's what she did. Herodias convinced her daughter, Herod's stepdaughter, to do a seductive dance for Herod because she had seen a way that Herod looked at his stepdaughter. And so Herodias' daughter did this seductive dance for Herod, and Herod was so excited about this dance that his stepdaughter had done, he yells to his stepdaughter, "Ask me for anything you want, and it's yours." And her mom tells her, "Ask for the head of John the Baptist on a platter." And Herod does what she asks. John the Baptist, this good man, suffers while evil people dance. A good man is murdered while bad people simply sit around and smirk. And John the Baptist himself struggled with this. Before his death, he was sitting in prison, and he struggled with the silence of God here. In Matthew chapter 11, we can see this. Matthew chapter 11, verse 2, it says this: "When John heard in prison what Christ was doing, he sent his disciples to ask him, 'Are you the one who was to come, or should we expect someone else?'" John the Baptist, I mean, look what's going on here. John the Baptist is the one who baptized Jesus. I mean, he'd seen Jesus at the beginning of his ministry, and now, though, he's in prison, and God's not doing what God ought to do, he felt like, and he doesn't understand why his circumstances haven't changed. And if Jesus is really the one, why doesn't he do something about his circumstances? And so John the Baptist writes to Jesus and says, ask him, is he really the one? Because if he is, why am I going through what I'm going through? Why doesn't he do something about my circumstances? Why is God silent in the midst of such great need? It's the silence of God sometimes robs us of our joy. Jesus himself knew the silence of God. You remember how in Matthew 26, before Jesus is about to be crucified and beaten and tortured, he goes to the Garden of Gethsemane. And the scripture says that he prayed, and it begins with this in verse 38. "Then he said to his disciples, 'My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me.' Going a little farther, he fell with his face to the ground and prayed, 'My Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me, yet not as I will, but as you will.'" Jesus prays to God, "God, I don't want to do this. I don't want to go through this. I don't want to die this way. I don't want to be tortured. I don't want to be beaten. Dad, can you get me out of this? Will you do something? Will you provide another way? Will you change the circumstances of my life at this moment? God, would you do something?" And then Jesus looks up to heaven, awaiting the reply of his Father. The answer is silence. The answer is silence. And Jesus goes to the cross and is beaten, tortured, crucified. You know, I would guess that for many of you here, you know what the silence of God is like. I feel like I was acquainted early with the silence of God when my brother, who was 6 years old, was in a car wreck and his leg was mangled, and the church got together to pray. I was 12, and I can remember the church coming together for times of prayer and holding 24-hour prayer times for Tommy, and we prayed that God would heal his leg, and we knew that God was capable of healing his leg. And we prayed and prayed, and then the gangrene set in, and his leg began to rot, and they amputated his leg. When God could do something, God was silent. I remember when I was 18, there was a young girl in our youth group. Her name was Becky Easterday, sweetest, cutest little girl you could have ever imagined. She was actually my little brother's girlfriend at the time, she was diagnosed with leukemia at the age of 12. We got together as a church and we prayed for her. We had the 24-hour, we fasted, people prayed continuously. We laid hands on her. We did everything we were supposed to do. We knew that God could heal her. But 2 months after her diagnosis of leukemia, she was dead. God could have done something, and God was silent. I've sat with moms who have lost their babies that we've prayed for, and there they've holding their child they've lost that's dead, and when we know that God could act and God could work, and yet in the silence of God, we sometimes struggle. And if we're not careful, the silence of God can rob us of our joy. And sometimes church isn't helpful because we come to church and we hear about the miracles of God. I mean, it's great we come to church and somebody says, I had cancer and God healed me, and that's great, except your spouse had cancer and God didn't heal them. They died. We come to church and somebody talks about how God miraculously repaired their relationship, and you think, that's great, but my relationship was not miraculously repaired and my spouse left me. We come to church and hear about how God provided for somebody, and God provided the financial means for them to get out of debt, and they didn't lose their house, they didn't go into bankruptcy, and that's wonderful, and everybody claps because God worked in the most amazing ways, except in your life, you had to go bankrupt, and you lost the house, and you lost the business, and you lost the car, and when you cried out to God, it seems to you that God was silent in that moment. And we begin to think, there must be something wrong with me. I mean, God heals other people, and God restores relationships, and God does all these things. It must be me. Maybe I don't have enough faith. Maybe it's because of my past or something I did, or maybe God's mad at me. I don't understand, but somehow I can't understand the silence of God. It's because we so often don't understand that the silence of God is just as biblical and just as real as the miracle of God. Now, I gave you three examples right here. And when people cried out to God and it seemed that God was silent, that's just as real as the miracles of God. In fact, I like the way Joshua, the book of Joshua, begins. Joshua is, Moses has died, and Joshua is taking over as the leader of the Israelites. And in verse 5 of chapter 1 of Joshua, God is speaking to Joshua, and he says these words. He says, "No one will be able to stand up against you all the days of your life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I will never leave you nor forsake you." Listen carefully to what God is telling Joshua. God says, hey, listen, nobody will ever be able to overtake you. But then God says to Joshua, I will never leave you nor forsake you. Now, why does God need to tell Joshua that? I mean, why does God need to say, Joshua, listen to me. I will never leave you nor forsake you. Why does he need to tell him that? God is saying to Joshua, there are going to be some times when you're going to wonder what I'm up to. There are going to be some times when it feels like I've left you. There are going to be some times when it feels like I'm not working when you feel like I ought to be doing something. There are going to be times when you don't understand the story that's going on. And he says, in those times, I want you to trust me. In those times, I haven't left you. I haven't forsaken you. I'm still loving you. I'm there. In those times when you feel my silence, when it doesn't look like I'm working, I want you to know that I love you. And it's as if God is saying to Joshua, what Andy said to Barney. It's in those times when you're asked to believe the impossible that you find out if you have faith in somebody or not. It's in those times when the evidence is all to the contrary that you find whether you have faith in somebody or not. And trusting God and believing in His love in those moments of silence is one of the keys to discovering a joy that the world and all its circumstances can't take away. Job struggled with what God was up to, and God finally answers Job in Job chapter 38 and says these words to him right here, beginning in verse 1. Then the Lord answered Job out of the storm. He said, "Who is this that darkens my counsel with words without knowledge? Brace yourself like a man. I will question you, and you shall answer me. Where were you when I laid the earth's foundation? Tell me if you understand. Who marked off its dimensions? Surely you know. Who stretched a measuring line across it? On what were its footings set, or who laid its cornerstone? While the morning stars sang together and all the angels shouted for joy. Who shut up the sea behind doors when it burst forth from the womb? When I made the cloud its garment and wrapped it in thick darkness. When I fixed limits for it and set its doors and bars in place. When I said, 'This is how far you may come and no farther. Here is where your proud waves halt.' Have you ever given orders to the morning or shown the dawn its place? That it might take the earth by the edges and shake the wicked out of it? The earth takes shape like clay under a seal. Its features stand out like those of a garment. The wicked are denied their light and their upraised arm is broken. Have you journeyed to the springs of the sea or walked in the recesses of the deep? Have the gates of death been shown to you? Have you seen the gates of the shadow of death? Have you comprehended the vast expanses of the earth? Tell me if you know all this." God finally answers Job as Job says, "God, where are you? Why don't you speak?" And when God answers Job, he answers in a way that probably is not always very satisfactory to many of us. God doesn't say, "Job, let me explain it to you. Let me show you why I'm doing everything that I've done. Let me kind of lay it out for you in a way that you can understand, and I'll take your questions one by one." God doesn't do that with Job. God simply says to Job, "Hey, were you there when I laid the foundations of the earth? Have you journeyed to the deepest depth of the sea? I mean, were you there when I put the stars in place?" God simply says to Job, "Job, you don't understand. There are things I know that you don't know and things I see that you don't see." And listen, right now, if you want to know joy, you have to trust me. Trust me. And it's like Job looked up to God, and God spoke to Job as Opie spoke to Andy. "Don't you believe me? Don't you believe my love?" And in those moments when God is silent, God asks you, "Don't you believe him? Don't you believe his love? Don't you believe his love?" You know why we believe in his love? Because he's demonstrated it for us. And when Jesus heard the silence of God, when Jesus cried out, "God, if there's some other way, let it happen," I don't believe that God listened in disinterested silence. I believe that when Jesus prayed, that God dug his fingernails in the side of the throne. I believe that the angels begged, "God, do something. Let us go. Not for those people." I believe the host of heaven were crying out, "God, not this way. Not your son." But God was silent in that moment because he loved you. Because he loves you that much. And believing in that love, even when all the evidence is to the contrary, is the key to joy. You see, I've seen this over and over again in the last 20 years of ministry. I've seen that people respond in two very different ways to the silence of God. Some people get angry. Some people become distant from God. Some people lose faith. Some people become bitter. And yet, other people in the midst of similar circumstances, rather than becoming distant and bitter and angry, they become closer to God. They become more faithful. They pull closer to the body of Christ. They experience this deep peace that is hard to explain according to the circumstances of their lives. And as I've watched people, those two different reactions come from two different ways of handling the silence of God. See, some people demand that God answer all their questions. Some people demand that God show them all the answers, that God explain to them what God is up to. And those who seek out all the answers and demand that God explain himself to them, I more often than not see them taking a path toward bitterness and anger and distance from God. Because sometimes there's no answer that God can give to me that's going to satisfy me for why God didn't do what I want him to do. Let's just be honest. When we demand answers, why? And that sometimes that's a road to bitterness. The people that I've seen respond in a different way, the people who've not got caught up with the questions of why, but who have focused on the who, are the people I see experiencing joy and peace and life. They don't focus on the why it happened. They simply focus on who is in charge. They focus on who loves them. And they say to God, God, I don't know. I don't know how this can ever make sense. I don't know how this story can ever play out in a way that somehow ends up justifying you as a loving and graceful God. But God, I know you, and I love you, and I trust you. It's in those moments when you're asked to believe the impossible, it's in those moments that you decide whether you have faith in somebody or not. And faith in God, who loves you so much that he gave his son to die for you, faith in him is what brings joy that the world can't touch. It's not in our circumstances. It's knowing the depth of his love for us. There's our joy. Let's pray. Gracious God, I thank you. I thank you that you have proven your love toward us. God, I thank you for how far you've gone that we might be fully convinced that you love us without fail. God, I thank you that even when we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, and Lord, sometimes we're going to walk through those times. Lord, and it's going to seem that you're far away. I thank you that your word tells us that when we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, we don't have to fear any evil, for you are with us. Lord, even when we can't see your hand, when we can't feel your presence, when you don't act in ways that we think you ought to act, Lord, we know that you love us. And someday, the scripture says that today we only see dimly, but someday we're going to see face to face. Lord, I believe that someday we're going to stand in heaven, and we're going to see far more than we see now. We're going to praise you, and we're going to love you, and we're going to say that you are a righteous God and a loving God and a grace-filled God. And we're going to realize that you never forsook us, that you never abandoned us, that you are loving us all the time. I don't know how in some of the situations I've experienced and seen, Lord, I don't know how you're going to do that, but I know that you will. I don't understand the circumstances of life, but I believe in you, and I believe in the depth of your love for us, and that you'll never forsake us or abandon us. And I praise you for that. God, I pray that you'd be with those who are walking through some difficult times. Some people right now in our church family who are experiencing what feels like your silence. And Lord, you just called them just to trust you for a little while. God, I just pray that they would look toward you, that they would remember your story of how far you've gone. I pray that you just impress upon them, give them faith to just believe, even when they can't see. Lord, give them the faith to know that you love them and that you're going to walk with them through this and that you're working out all things for them. Lord, we praise you and thank you for your doing that. Lord, we love you. We thank you for the joy that you've placed in our hearts, a joy that comes from our faith in you that's undiminished by the circumstances of life. And for that joy, we give you praise now and forever. In Jesus' name, amen.